We're going to continue in our study this morning about the Word of God and how God has preserved it through the centuries, through the ages, and why we can be confident that we have God's Word preserved for us today because of the process of preservation. Preservation is something that God has done through the ages, but through the terminology is providential preservation, but through the members of the body of Christ, through saints in time past, the believers in Israel's program, through the process of the faithful men who copied out the scriptures through the ages, that process of copying out is the process whereby God preserved His Word. We've looked at verses where God promises He's going to preserve His Word so that the people in future generations from us today would have access to His Word. Now, we've talked about how His Word orders us and through the ages has given charge to individuals in every generation to read His Word and know it, because they will be judged by it one day. So God can't be just to tell all generations from the beginning of the Scriptures until now that they're going to be judged from His Word if it's not available to them to be judged out of. So the accountability is there for us to study it, because God promises it's going to be available for us to study. So then it's a process of believing the Scriptures and looking by faith to where we think the Word of God would be found today. And that, for English speaking people, is in the King James Bible. Now, it's an easy process to see why that would be the case, but you have to look with the eye of faith and not through man's wisdom. Because man's human wisdom, fallible, the wisdom of the old nature, is going to look in the wrong place for the Word of God today. And so the Word of God, though, if you study it, reveals in it how it is that God preserved His Word. And we're going to continue in our studies this morning. And by a quick review, turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And we're going to look at verses 6 through 9. Verse 6, "And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates." Now the point is, with God having His Word written down and available for it to be copied out, is that every individual in the Scriptures is expected to have a copy. So we see here the assumption is every person in the nation of Israel is going to have a copy of that law, and they're going to teach it to their children. Now, the only way that's possible is for them to have a copy in the house. They can't run down to the tabernacle and have the priest read it to them. Everybody has to have a copy. And this passage we just read is clear that each individual, it's not just for the wealthy. Okay, why is it not for the wealthy? Well, if you had to buy a copy that somebody hand copied out, you can imagine that would have to be expensive, because it's going to take somebody a lot of time, right? But if you make your own copy of the Scripture, and that's what was expected, was that the parents had a Bible, the child is going to copy their own version out of the Bible. So it's expected that everybody know how to read and write, and so that they can have a copy of the Word of God, so that they can have it to be accountable, so that they can have it as their guide, their light, their comfort, their strength. You know, they can have the advantage of having the Word of God. So we have passages like this that show us that the Bible wasn't as if you read tradition and history, they'll tell you only the wealthy had copies and so forth. Well, you know, if you read the scriptures, that doesn't bear to be true. I think it was Wycliffe that said his objective, and perhaps Tyndale said it too, but was that every plowboy have a copy of the Word of God. Well, that was made available through the printing press. But you can see people had gotten away from copying, making their own copy of the scripture and handing it down from generation to generation. And that's actually the way God expected it to be done. But thankfully, we can go buy a copy of the Word of God. But it's through the process of copies, making thousands of copies, multiple copies, for each individual to have in their possession, having the, thus saith the Lord, in their possession, that preservation is possible. Because you have originals, and then a copy of the original is made. And those copies are probably several copies that are given to the scribes in Israel's program. And then they use that copy to make other copies. And they wear their copy out. They have the original to go back to and compare until that original scroll, all of the full law, all of the books of Deuteronomy were on scrolls. They weren't all on stone. The ten were on stone and put in the Ark of the Covenant, but obviously, you know, Moses didn't write everything on stone, or they would have, you know, it would have taken quite a bit to hold all that and carry it around. So they were copied out, and those scrolls would eventually wear out. And so enough, there had to be copies made so that when the original copy wore out, you had accurate, reliable copies to continue to copy out the Word of God and publish it and make sure everybody had copies. We saw last week that the king was commanded. Before Israel had kings, God said, when you have a king, he is to make himself a copy of my word. And so it wasn't made for him, he copied it out. And if you've ever copied information out of a book or whatever, you know that that's one of the best ways to learn it anyway. Information is to copy. If you want to learn a verse, memorize it. The good thing to do is write it out, and then it helps you to memorize it. So there's a value, not just in preservation, for them to have copied out the scripture for themselves and have it. We saw that Moses had the original tablets of stone, and he broke them, and God said, come up into the mountain again, and we're going to make another set of originals. And so the issue with the Word of God, we looked in Jeremiah, and we saw that Jeremiah wrote the whole book of Jeremiah, big book, and it was written on a scroll, and the king and burned the copy, the original. And God told Jeremiah, I'm going to give you another one, and he added to it. God gave more to add to it. The curse is upon Israel because of Israel's rebellion and defiance against God's word, against the law. So we can see throughout the scriptures, the originals are never the issue with God preserving his word. But that's what man's wisdom looks at. Man's wisdom, with all the other versions beside the King James, all the English translations are all from a corrupted Greek text. And the Greek text that they're translating has many omissions, deletions of the Word of God and words in the Word of God. Talking about the main attack in those corruptions have to do with the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ and attack who he is. They're not just accidental, I left a word out when I was copying. They're from men, Gnostics, and other people in time past, back in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd century, Origen and other men like him that had a design to attack certain doctrines in the original Greek text, and they took big sections out and changed them to fit their doctrine. And then those copies were translated. That was the basis of the Catholic Bible for the centuries. The Catholic Church used it for their Bible. And then, as you know, through the ages, the Catholic Church, if you had a copy of the true text in your own language to read, that was against the law of the Catholic Church, and you were to be put to death for it. So for many, the Dark Ages had a lot to do with people being kept in the dark and not encouraged to read the Bible themselves and not to have it in their own language. That's why the church taught in Latin. And it was just Satan used that whole religion to attack God's word and keep it from going to the people, because it brings salvation and light everywhere the Word of God goes. But there's always been a people that upon risk of their life have maintained the pure copies of the Word of God, copied it out, and made sure enough people had it that they could compare copies and make new copies and copy out the Word of God, and that's how we have it today. So the issue has never been the originals. In fact, the Bible, as far as all the prophets being given additional books, there's 39 books in the Old Testament and 27 books in the New Testament. Well, there's never been a time when all the originals were in one place at the same time, ever. So the issue's never been originals. The issue's always been, what is the fullest copy, the correct copy of the Scriptures? And there's only one Greek text that's the full, complete Greek text, and that's the one that was translated in the King James Bible, is where we find it today in English. So the issue's been copies. Go with me to Psalm 68 now, and we're going to look at verse 11. Psalm chapter 68, verse 11. Just a verse that that kind of shows us how through the process of time that this was accomplished, everybody had copies of the Word of God. Verse 11 of Psalm 68, the Lord gave the word, great was the company of those that published it. So you had this army of people through the ages. The scribes in the Old Testament, when it had to do with Israel's program, you had the priesthood, the tribe of Levi, and there were many scribes who copied out the Scriptures, making sure everybody had copies of the Word of God. They were published, they were distributed throughout the world even. We're going to look at next, I want you to go to Proverbs 25. So after God gave the first five books of the Bible to Moses to write down, there were more prophets that were given Scriptures, and those rolls were added to the Word of God, and they were read and copied and wore out. And in Proverbs chapter 25, we're going to read verse 1. You have to appreciate what you have in your hand today. It's God promised that it would be available to you, and the mind of faith will find where it is in your language today. And you have to appreciate the great sacrifice that was involved for you to have it intact as the Word of God, that God used believers throughout the ages to make that possible. Chapter 25, verse 1, these are also proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out. So you see the Bible is just continuously being copied out, and through the process of preservation, it's being made available to everybody and copied out. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 2. Daniel 9, verse 2. Daniel, as you know, he's an exile. He was carried out of Jerusalem into captivity, the Babylonian captivity. He, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you know that story of the three in the furnace, fiery furnace. Daniel is in Babylon, and he's in chapter 9, verse 2, we read, we'll read verse 1. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans. Well, that's Chaldean, Babylonian, Babylonians. Verse 2, remember Abraham, Ur of Chaldees, was where he was from. That's down by Babylon. Verse 2, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood. First year of Darius's reign, he's saying. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. Now here's Daniel away in captivity in Babylon, and what does he have? He has copies of the Word of God, books available to him that he can study, and he has a copy of the book of Jeremiah that we know how the book of Jeremiah came to be, and it was given by the Lord again after the original destroyed. So here Daniel has a copy of God's word. He calls it the word of the Lord. So he had a preserved copy of the Bible that he could trust were thus saith the Lord, were God's words. Now go to chapter 10 and verse 18 of Daniel. 10 verse 18. Daniel prays to have understanding of what he had been reading. And in verse 10, then there came again and touched me, one like the appearance of a man, and he strengthened me. And he said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be unto thee. Be strong, yea, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. Then said he, Knowest thou whereof I am come unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael your prince. So this angel is going to show Daniel in the copy of the scriptures that he has, which the angel refers to as the scripture of truth. Angel has a copy of the word of God, and it's not the original. And yet it's faithful enough and reliable that this angel from heaven says that's the scripture of truth that Daniel has. So Daniel has a copy of the scripture of truth hundreds of years, probably, perhaps, well, I don't know the length of time between him and Jeremiah, but Daniel has books. He's studying the Bible and no doubt has copies of the whole Bible. So he's got Moses' writings and he's got the whole Bible available for him to study. And in his day, the angel can refer to the copies that he had as the scripture of truth. Go with me to Matthew now, chapter 24, verse 15. Matthew 24, 15. Now, the Lord is speaking here to his disciples, and he's telling them about the tribulation period, the time we know as Jacob's trouble, the 70th week of Daniel, the last 7 years of Israel's prophetic program before the Lord comes back to set up his kingdom. And he's speaking about those future things that are going to happen. And in Matthew 24, verse 15, you read, When ye shall therefore see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophets stand in the holy place, whosoever readeth, let him understand. Then let them which be in Judea flee to the mountains. Whosoever readeth. So that is instruction for those that are going to be living through that time of tribulation that for us today is still future. We're not going to go through that time of great tribulation for Israel, because the rapture is where God's going to take his church, the body of Christ, up and deliver us from the wrath that's going to come upon this world, that prophesied wrath that was given to the nation of Israel, explaining the last days upon the earth before the Lord comes and sets up his kingdom. But he says, whosoever readeth, let him understand. So we know today God has promised to have his word available for that generation that's going to live through the tribulation period. So if it's going to be available out there, and if they had it in the Lord's day, then that means that we're going to have it in between in this time today, in this dispensation of grace. We'll have the scripture of truth available to us, the word of God. Go with me now to chapter 8 of Acts in verse 26. We're going to read through verse 25. I mean 35. Acts 26. We're going to start reading in verse Acts chapter 8, verse 26 through 35. Verse 26. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning, and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Now, in the New Testament, Isaiah is spelt with an E. So, you know, it's possibly, I was going to say the correct pronunciation for the book of Isaiah, but I'm not, I don't necessarily think that's true. But it's the pronunciation of it's the translation of the Hebrew word into Greek and written down here, translated from Greek to English as E-S-A-I-A-S. And so here is this Ethiopian eunuch who has a copy in his possession of the book of Isaiah. Now, he was able to read Isaiah and receive eternal life by believing what the scriptures said in Isaiah about the Lord. And when Philip explained to him who he was reading about, and this Ethiopian eunuch was saved by believing that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. It was part of the gospel that he had to believe to be saved in that time. So here the Ethiopian eunuch, and he's not a Hebrew, I mean, he's not born in the land, a Jew born in the land, but this is an Ethiopian eunuch down in Ethiopia, right, that has a copy there that he had brought with him of the book of Isaiah. So the Word of God isn't just found in that area of the world around Palestine, but it was copied out and disseminated and published, and it was throughout the world at that time. Acts chapter 15. In fact, there's this council that takes place in Jerusalem over the issue of the Jews that persecuted Paul telling Gentiles that they needed to be circumcised and keep the law in order to be saved. They didn't understand. The Jews that told the Gentiles that didn't understand salvation themselves, but they also were corrupting the gospel. The book of Galatians talks about what they were doing. And here this council takes place in the book, recorded in our Bibles in Jerusalem in the book of Acts chapter 15. In chapter 15, read with me verse 21. For Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. So what's the point? In chapter 15 of the book of Acts, the point that they didn't need to worry about teaching the Gentiles about the law is that if they want to understand the law, all they have to do is go to any synagogue, and it's being taught in the synagogues because they have copies of the Word of God there that they're teaching out of every synagogue. Now, that's not talking about synagogues in Judea or Jerusalem. That's talking about synagogues that are in the area where Paul was preaching, in Pisidia and in Eastern Europe. All these synagogues had the Word of God. So the Word of God's throughout the world. The Ethiopian eunuch had his copy. Daniel had his copy in Babylon. It's throughout. All the synagogues have copies. And so people could make their own copy from those copies. And that's how the Bible was copied out and available today. We have fragments and scraps of manuscripts from all over the world that were kept, and we can put those together. There are 5,000 manuscripts and fragments that support the fuller reading of the Greek text that we have in our King James Bible. And they were found in the areas, the Mediterranean areas, the areas that you would expect the Word of God to have been published and available to everybody in those areas where Paul preached. That's where they found the cursive handwritten manuscripts where people had copied out the Word of God, and so that they would have it. I think I would want to write it in cursive if I was making my copy. I mean, it's a lot quicker to write that than capital block Greek letters, isn't it? So the wrong text was always found in the block Greek letters, and that's why I say that. But the true text was found in Koine Greek, the everyday language Greek that people spoke and wrote and had available to them. So the Bible's published throughout the world. Go with me to chapter 17 now in verse 2. Chapter 17, verse 2. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. So Paul, you know, could go into any synagogue, and there would be a copy of the Word of God for him to read. Convenient, right? You know, people get confused by the fact that Paul went into synagogues when he's the apostle of the Gentiles. So they think, okay, if he went into synagogues, he must have had to go to the Jews first. Well, you know, the Scripture's clear. It says, as his manner was, verse 2, Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them in 3 days, in 3 Sabbath days, reasoned with them out of the Scriptures. If you're going to preach to a bunch of Jews, when God first changed the program, you better talk to them first when you went into town if you want their audience, if you want them to listen to you. And then, if they don't believe, they reject it, or once they've had a chance to hear it, then you can turn and talk to the Gentiles, because the Jews that didn't believe, they were incensed about the fact that Gentiles were being given the Word of God, heathen Gentiles. And they surely weren't, if they wouldn't believe it when Paul gave them the first opportunity, they surely weren't going to believe it after he turned to the Gentiles when he went into the cities and preached the gospel to everyone equally. So Luke chapter 16 now. Go to Luke 16. Luke chapter 16, verse 22. And we're going to read down through 31. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels unto Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldst send him to my father's house, for I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they would repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither would they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Now, that's a couple very important points that are made there. One, the assumption is everybody is accountable for salvation. Everybody in that day had what they needed to hear in order to repent and believe God and be saved in their program. But, you know, so here one guy ends up in torment. He's thinking, if somebody was raised from the dead and went and said to them, you better repent and believe God, get right with God in that day. That's not the dispensation of grace. That's before that, and that we're reading about. If you better believe that the current gospel, that Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is the Christ. Trust in Him, because He is the Redeemer for Israel. He's the one who's going to bring in the new covenant for Israel. He's the one you need to believe in, that He's the Christ. And He says, if they won't believe the Scripture, what the Scriptures say about Him being Christ, they're not going to believe if somebody came up from the dead and told them about it. So that's a really interesting point. Many people today think if a miracle happened, they would believe in God. But aside from a miracle, they just can't believe in the God of a book. And that verse tells us, if they won't believe God's book, they wouldn't believe a miracle. So the Word of God is authoritative. It is what it claims to be. It is preserved. And that preservation is possible only through the copying out of the Scriptures.